In this lecture, we are going to cover the pharmacology of antiepileptic drugs, so let's get right into it. The primary use of antiepileptic drugs is to prevent or control epilepsy, commonly known as seizure. A seizure is a sudden burst of uncontrolled electrical activity in the brain that occurs when neurons become excessively active. Seizures can be generally classified into two major groups depending on where they begin in the brain. First, focal seizures affect initially only a portion of the brain, typically one hemisphere, and may occur with or without impairment of awareness. Second, generalized seizures affect both sides of the brain at the same time and almost always cause loss of consciousness. Now, simplistically, seizures can be viewed as the result of an imbalance between inhibitory and excitatory processes in the brain that produces either too little inhibition or too much excitation. In order to gain better understanding of how this happens, we need to take a closer look at how neurons pass signals to one another. So as you probably already know, the main form of communication among neurons occurs through the traveling wave of electrical excitation, known as an action potential. An action potential is orchestrated by the synchronized opening and closing of ion channels. Now, if we look at the simple excitatory neuron, when at rest, the inside is slightly more negative than the outside. An action potential starts when voltage-gated sodium channels open, allowing positively charged sodium ions to rush into the cell, thus reversing depolarization of the membrane. Consequently, membrane depolarization leads to opening of high-voltage activated calcium channels, which then allow positively charged calcium ions enter the neuron, thereby triggering release of glutamate from the vesicles into the synaptic cleft. Next, glutamate binds to two types of receptors on the postsynaptic neuron. First, the AMPA receptors that upon binding of glutamate open and permit entry of sodium ions, and the second, NMDA receptors that open and permit entry of calcium ions. In addition to that, calcium may enter through low voltage activated calcium channels, also known as T-type calcium channels, which open in response to small depolarizations at or below resting membrane potential. So all this influx of positive ions again leads to depolarization and propagation of action potential. Now, as you can imagine, if there is too much glutamate around, neurons can become hyperexcitable and a seizure may result. But this normally doesn't happen, because we also have inhibitory neurons around that put brakes on excitatory impulses. These inhibitory neurons release neurotransmitter GABA, which binds to GABA-A receptors on the excitatory neuron, causes them to open and allow negatively charged chloride ions to enter in. This causes the membrane potential to be more negative on the inside relative to the outside, thus limiting the neuron's ability to respond to further stimulation. Finally, once GABA dissociates from the GABA-A receptor, it becomes removed from the synaptic cleft by reuptake through the GABA transporter 1, GAT1 for short, and then degraded by an enzyme gamma-aminobutyric acid aminotransferase, GABA-AT for short. So again, as you can see, just like with excess of glutamate, too little GABA can also allow neurons to become hyperexcitable, which may lead to seizures. Now that we covered the basic mechanism underlying seizures, let's move on to discussing pharmacology of antiepileptic drugs. So the main goal of therapeutic interventions is to simply lower neuronal excitability and/or enhance neuronal inhibition. One way antiepileptic drugs may prevent excessive firing of an action potential on neurons is simply by blocking voltage-gated sodium channels. Antiepileptics that block sodium channels and thus reduce the amount of sodium that enters the neuron include carbamazepine, oxcarbazepine, lamotrigine, phenytoin, topiramate, valproic acid, and zonisamide. Now, another way antiepileptics can slow down hyperactive neurons is by blocking calcium channels. This task gets done by drugs that inhibit high-voltage activated calcium channels, such as lamotrigine and topiramate, and drugs that inhibit low-voltage activated T-type calcium channels, such as valproic acid and zonisamide. As a side note here, keep in mind that many of the antiepileptic drugs act on multiple targets, so as you can see, lamotrigine, topiramate, valproic acid, and zonisamide can inhibit both calcium channels and sodium channels. Furthermore, topiramate has been shown to also inhibit excitatory neurotransmission by blocking AMPA receptors. Now, a couple other antiepileptic drugs, namely gabapentin and pregabalin, also exert their effects by interacting with high-voltage activated calcium channels. However, unlike the other agents, gabapentin and pregabalin bind to an accessory subunit of the high-voltage activated calcium channel called alpha-2-delta-1. Because the presynaptic channels that contain this specific subunit appear to modulate the release of excitatory neurotransmitters such as glutamate, inhibition of alpha-2-delta-1 containing calcium channels by gabapentin and pregabalin is speculated to be one of the main reasons for their antiepileptic effect. Another high-voltage activated calcium channel blocker with unique mechanism of action is levetiracetam. One of the major mechanisms that is speculated to be responsible for anti-seizure activity of levetiracetam is its ability to bind to the so-called SV2A protein found in the walls of vesicles that contain glutamate. This binding appears to impair the synaptic release of glutamate and thus decrease neuronal excitability. Next, we have antiepileptic drug called Felbamate that inhibits excitatory neurotransmission by blocking NMDA receptors. And finally, we have drugs that act on the GABA system. The two major classes of drugs that target this system are benzodiazepines and barbiturates, which work by binding to GABA-A receptor, thus prolonging the opening of the channel and permitting greater influx of negatively charged chloride ions into the neuron. For a more detailed explanation of their mechanism of action, check out my recent video about benzodiazepines and barbiturates. Next, we have a drug called Tiagabine, which is a selective inhibitor of the GABA transporter. In a nutshell, Tiagabine simply blocks GABA reuptake, thereby permitting more GABA to be available for receptor binding on the postsynaptic neurons. Last but not least, we have a drug called Vigabatrin, which irreversibly inhibits GABA aminotransferase, the enzyme responsible for catabolism of GABA, thereby effectively increasing the concentrations of GABA in the brain. Now, when it comes to side effects, sedation and dizziness can occur with all antiepileptic drugs. Hyponatremia can occur with the use of carbamazepine and oxcarbazepine. Visual field loss can occur with the use of vigabatrin, while double vision can occur with the use of a lamotrigine and phenytoin. Additionally, phenytoin is known for causing gingival hyperplasia and hirsutism. Cognitive problems can occur with the use of topiramate and zonisamide. Topiramate is also known for causing weight loss. Weight gain, on the other hand, can occur most frequently with the use of valproic acid, although it has also been reported with the use of gabapentin and pregabalin, which also happen to cause peripheral edema. In addition to that, both valproic acid and felbamate can cause liver toxicity. In rare cases, the use of felbamate can also lead to rare but serious condition called aplastic anemia. And with that, I wanted to thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video, and as always, stay tuned for more.